People love Kings Island.
It feels like you're doing 90 around these turns and things.
Generations of memories.
It's like family.
Colossal thrills.
After all the hype, the son of Beast is finally unleashed.
And a ruthless race to the top.
There's a war getting ready to start. This is the battlefield.
This reached proportions and size unlike anything we had ever seen. What in the world did we create?
This is the little-known story of America's coastal wars and how the fierce rivalries that fueled one of the world's best theme parks also led to dangerous consequences.
These were some of the 27 who were taken to the hospital after something went wrong.
What do you got planned for the summer?
Go swimming, go to Kings Island.
People who live in greater Cincinnati ask anybody, stop on the street, what's your theme park, your amusement park? Kings Island. I was assistant general manager and responsible for operations.
Kings Island Amusement Park, just north of Cincinnati, Ohio, has been luring thrill seekers to its gates since 1972. The park consistently ranks as one of the top theme parks in the nation, and its roller coasters hold world records for size and speed. But none of it would have been possible without some creative Russian inventors.
The history of the roller coasters started out in Russia in the 16th and 17th century. What it was basically a block of ice with some hay in it that the people slid down the mountain on. It just really caught on in Europe, and they started putting wheels on carts, and then it was exported to the U.S.
The first coaster prototype in the U.S. is built in 1827, the Mock Chunk Switchback Railway, a repurposed coal mining train in Pennsylvania that sends adrenaline junkies hurtling down a mountain. Coasters quickly spread across the country with over 1,500 in operation by the 1920s. The legendary Disneyland theme park opens in 1955. The first Six Flags theme park opens a few years later. And on the banks of the Ohio River, a park dubbed the Coney Island of the Midwest hits its stride.
Coney Island actually started in the late 1800s as a Parker's Grove. It was a picnic area. They copied the name from New York because it was so well known back then. Coney Island really was one of America's finest amusement parks. There was a gentleman whose family was part owner of Coney Island, Gary Wachs. He began in the 60s talking about expanding and growing and moving because he had seen what Disney had done. At the same time, a local company here called Taft Broadcasting Company, they had just bought a company out in California called Hanna-Barbera.
Wanting to capitalize on their cartoons in 1969, Taft and Coney Island announced a new amusement park called Kings Island is coming to Mason, Ohio. Its name combines the location Kings Mills and the park's predecessor, Coney Island. 2 years and $31 million later, Kings Island is ready to compete in the big leagues as one of the greatest theme parks ever.
We had a feasibility study done by a gentleman named Mr. Thompson. He said, you're going to do 2 million people your first season. And that was quite an endeavor. Only Disney had done that.
But attendance is off to a slow start. Achieving their goal of 2 million people starts to feel impossible.
July 4th, 1972, I'll never forget this. The spigot opened up and the people started pouring into the park. And we had 40,000 people that day. So the remainder of that season, we were doing between 40 and 35,000 people a day. We did 2,012,000 people. And that put us among the ranks of Disneyland and Disney World in cracking the 2 million barrier in our first season of operation. No one had ever done that other than those parks.
the park's iconic wooden roller coaster, the Racer, draws massive crowds. Its success fuels the fire into what later becomes known as the Coaster Wars.
The Racer was really what launched the renaissance of the roller coaster to the magnitude of what it is today.
True to its name, the Racer is a classic out-and-back wooden coaster where riders in two cars race along the twin tracks. Building a wooden roller coaster was a bold choice at the time.
Disney and Six Flags, who were both operating parks, felt that roller coasters were passé. They were carnival. They were done.
Park executives took a gamble, and it pays off. Big time. Their success catches the eye of a top competitor.
The president of Six Flags said, "What is that line? Where's it going?" It was leading him to the entrance to the Racer. It was about a quarter of a mile long. That helped Six Flags understand how important roller coasters could be.
The Racer kickstarts a wooden coaster comeback. In its wake, more than 1,000 wooden coasters are built around the world.
When the coaster war emerged and everybody realized the importance of a roller coaster, it was a very exciting time because everyone was trying to outdo the other park. Cedar Point up in Sandusky, they put in the corkscrew coaster. Looping coasters were being developed at Magic Mountain in California in 1976. And even Disney then, they got in the race when they did Space Mountain, which was the indoor dark coaster. It was like, wow, look at what we can do. There was more twists, more turns, more inversions, more loops.
The competition goads engineers at Kings Island to create ever bigger and faster thrills.
Well, the mantra of the coaster was higher, longer, faster. It put pressure on the whole industry.
But in the race to win the coaster wars at all costs, do the parks go too far?
It felt like the cart went off the track.
We all thought we were dead.
By the 1980s, Kings Island Amusement Park, just outside of Cincinnati, had taken its rightful place in the country's coaster wars, alongside mega theme parks like Disney and Six Flags. The fan favorite is wooden roller coaster, the Racer, which attracts visitors from all over the country, some of whom set out to break records.
It makes no sense to ride the Racer 6,000 times. No sense, that is, unless you are 23-year-old Don Helbig of Cincinnati. Don holds the world's record for most rides on a single roller coaster. He started back in 1981. And today he established a new milestone, 6,000 rides.
I just wanted to see if I could set some kind of record on, you know, something, you know, just to kind of be different than everybody else.
There we go. You know, in 1981, I was working at Cincinnati Reds games at Riverfront Stadium. I was a novelty vendor, and they had the baseball strike. I didn't want to get another job. I just thought I'd fill the time by going to Kings Island. I was having fun with it. And the next thing you know, I've got 500 rides on it, 700 rides on it. And the day I got my 1,000th ride on it was the day that I had to report back to work at Riverfront Stadium. But I also became intrigued about, you know, public relations, just by being around the Kings Island PR staff all those years I was riding the Racer. That set the stage years later to come back to Kings Island as the park's PR manager in 2007.
To maintain its popular status alongside bigger parks, managers add new attractions, including nail-biting stunts.
Probably the most popular and biggest events that was ever put on was the Evel Knievel jump, where he jumped over the English buses in the parking lot.
The stunt proved so popular that Evel Knievel's son, Robbie Knievel, would later return to Kings Island to break his father's record.
Captain Knievel went airborne.
But through the 1970s, if Kings Island wants to stay competitive, the thrills need to keep getting bigger and better. Which leads to its biggest risk yet. In 1979, the park unleashes the Beast.
Kings Island dares you to come face to face with the Beast.
Someone came up with the idea of using some outward terrain that we had in the backside of the park which was really hard to build on, but it was perfect to build a new roller coaster.
At 7,361 feet long, with a 4-minute ride time, the Beast holds the title as the world's longest wooden roller coaster. A ride so ferocious, its terrifying reputation precedes it.
When the ride makes its debut next spring, there'll be only one thing missing. Me. I'm your basic chicken.
Former general manager Dennis Spiegel is one of the Beast's first human tests.
And we came out of there and all of our eyes were like this, like, what in the world did we create? We all thought we were dead. It was so scary.
To address safety concerns, engineers slowed down the ride ahead of officially opening. The monster of a coaster now takes brave riders at speeds up to 65 miles per hour through 35 acres of wilderness. There are massive vertical drops, a 125-foot-long underground tunnel, and a 540-degree helix tunnel at the very end.
The kids' favorite ride in the park?
The Beast.
Success from the Beast fuels King's Island's appetite to create record-breaking rides.
There was King Cobra in 1984, you know, the first stand-up coaster in the United States.
It feels like your stomach's gonna drop.
And it's fun,
don't it? It tingles your feet.
Then you had the Vortex in 1987. That was a record-breaking attraction, the first roller coaster to send riders through 6 inversions.
We got on the back, and the back, it feels like you're doing 90 around these turns and things.
It was great.
This guy closed his eyes on the first 2 loops.
I didn't even know we were going upside down. I was too scared to open my eyes.
We were the king of coasters. We were the guys who were doing it. People came in from all over the world to see us and ride these coasters, and that created that explosion.
By 1999, Paramount Parks is the new owner of King's Island, and whispers of a faster, more ferocious ride quickly spread.
The Beast rules, but not for long.
Paramount's King's Island is determined to break more records, outdoing even itself.
Paramount's King's Island is going to unleash on the world something that we can call the sequel to The Beast. This is the Son of Beast.
The ride climbs to a record-setting peak of 218 feet with trains reaching speeds up to 78 miles per hour. Its stature is impressive, but the ride causes trouble from the start. In the middle of construction, Paramount's King's Island fires the Roller Coaster Company of Ohio, the firm hired to design and build the ride. Instead, the park finishes the job themselves, correcting any structural issues they find. The ride opens to the public in 2000.
After all the wait, after all the hype, the Son of Beast is finally unleashed.
Yeah! The speed and all the elements that are in here make this a tremendous ride. It really is great.
Fans can't get enough of the Son of Beast, but the ride has a reputation for roughness.
There was nothing else like it out there, but, you know, it wasn't geared for, you know, the average park guest. A little too intense for that.
Intense. Real intense. That loop is really intense. Hey,
on June 30th, 2006, Paramount's King's Island is sold to Cedar Fair Entertainment Company for roughly $1.2 billion. Less than 2 weeks later, chaos strikes.
At 4:45 today, a Son of Beast train returned to the station after completing a full cycle.
We get on the ride and everything was fine until we went around the second loop and back down a hill, and we just kind of like jammed, felt like everything just jammed you forward. I tell you, it's like going 7-8 mile an hour and just hitting a wall or something is what it felt like.
The complaints shut down the world's tallest, fastest, only looping wooden roller coaster. Shortly after ambulance rushed to King's Island to transport 27 guests to the hospital.
It felt like the cart went off the track.
Yelling and screaming, trying to get off. Like, somebody broke her chest bone, and she was like, yeah, cussing and carrying on.
pretty bad.
There was a girl with a breathing mask on, and there was water in it, and she was sitting on the bench. There were many people crying.
After the accident in July 2006 results in dozens of serious injuries, questions swarm Kings Island, the most glaring of all. How did this happen? In Ohio, every single ride is licensed and inspected by the Ohio Department of Agriculture's Division of Amusement Ride Safety.
Each ride, each year, gets an inspection. They have to pass a complete mechanical inspection before we will issue that license.
Records show reports of injuries before the 2006 Son of Beast incident.
I found two incidents reported in 2001, another one in 2003. All three ruled patron error, the fault of the rider. Kings Island says every single ride undergoes an operational, mechanical, and electrical inspection every morning before the park opens.
There are critical components on the inspection on a daily basis are the wheel assemblies, which are located under here, the large road wheels, which run on top of the track. We then check the integrity of the whole body of the train, the steel components and the wood components.
After the July 2006 accident, employees walked the track to inspect every inch of the Son of Beast, eyeing for any loose nails, bolts, or wood. They discover a section of the track's wooden support had fractured after a train passed, causing it to sag about 5 inches. Plaintiffs file 5 lawsuits after the incident, but one case goes to trial. In the end, Jennifer Wright of Defiance, Ohio, is awarded over $76,000 in damages for hip injuries. Wright tells the Cincinnati Inquirer newspaper she would not settle unless the video testimony of forensic engineer Rick Shimizzi is made public.
I do.
The state investigator who examined the Son of Beast says Kings Island put riders at risk. In a video deposition, Rick Shimizzi dissected photos of the wooden coaster and structural weak points right down to the loose bolts.
I could have spun it with my finger.
It was that loose?
It was that loose. And this is not the failure location. This is another location.
Shimizzi says when the Sun debuted 9 years ago, park owners could tell the ride was swaying too much. But instead of shutting it down and treating the whole patient, a 5-acre coaster, they took a Band-Aid approach.
It was more of, let's see what we can do to kind of make it work along the way. And I thought that was a poor way to approach the problem.
The state's lead investigator says Kings Island had all the necessary information to make a sound decision about fixing the Son of Beast.
And in my opinion, they didn't make the correct decision.
The Son of Beast closes for the remainder of 2006. Kings Island pours millions of dollars in renovations, including removing its only loop. The park is desperate to bring back the ride. In 2007, the Son of Beast reopens and appears to be tamed, until June of 2009, when a woman claims she sustained a head injury while riding. A state investigation rules no design flaw caused her injury, but the ride closes for the rest of the season.
It's been rumored for some time, but the park made it official. No Son of Beast for 2010.
With all the initial capital that went into Son of Beast and the many years' worth of repairs, it's probably a $30 million investment. It would be a huge undertaking to take it out, let alone replace it with something comparable.
They gave it every chance to try to find a way to make that ride work. A lot of different manufacturers came out and put together proposals or, you know, if we did this, maybe it'll work, or I think this will work. Well, they had so many problems with this ride for, you know, the 8 or 9 years that it operated that it couldn't be maybe it's going to work. We think it's going to work. You know, it had to work.
We've always said that somebody stubbing their toe in a park is too much. To have an accident of proportion on a coaster like that is just beyond anything we can accept or imagine. And so it was part of the decision-making process to eventually tear it down. And it was the right decision, really.
Something big is coming.
I hope it's a water ride.
Where Son of Beast used to be.
I hope it's another roller coaster.
It looks like a pretty big area they're clearing out right there.
Signs warn of something evil.
Da, 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 da.
The wait is over. The world's longest inverted coaster is coming here to Kings Island next year, and it's going to sit right over here where Son of Beast used to roar. Kings Island's general manager tells me that's the reason for the name the Banshee, which is a mythical ghost-like creature from Irish folklore that would circle the dead, or in this case, the ground that used to be home to Son of Beast.
Fast, it's furious, and it's intense.
Despite fears that losing the Son of Beast would negatively impact attendance, the park rebounds. With the Son of Beast in the rearview mirror, the park continues to expand, introducing bigger and better rides like the steel coaster Orion in 2020.
The technological advancements in our industry are enormous and rapid. It's amazing how much it has changed in the last 20 years. For example, the linear induction motor concept, where you can reach speeds up to 90 miles an hour in 2.6 seconds. We have to keep it safe and sound and practical for the guests, but we keep pushing the envelope too.
Through 1972's The Racer to record-breaking coasters like The Beast, Kings Island draws crowds similar in size to the world's top theme parks. And through the years, the park proves that not even one problematic coaster can keep thrill seekers away.
Everybody wants to have fun. And Kings Island is one of those places where the family can still come as a unit and enjoy it. Our business, our industry, Kings Island, we put smiles on people's faces and we make memories that last a lifetime. And that's what we do. And I don't think it gets any better than that.